1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 1 to 8. Finally, brothers, we instructed you how to live in order to please God, as in fact you are living. Now we ask you and urge you in the Lord Jesus to do this more and more. For you know what instructions we gave you by the authority of the Lord Jesus. It is God's will that you should be sanctified, that you should avoid sexual immorality, that each of you should learn to control his own body in a way that is holy and honorable, not in passionate lust like the heathen who do not know God, and that in this matter no one should wrong his brother or take advantage of him. The Lord will punish men for all such sins, as we have already told you and warned you. For God did not call us to be impure, but to live a holy life. Therefore, he who rejects this instruction does not reject man, but God, who gives you his Holy Spirit.
There we go. I think the sermon I'm going to preach this morning might end up getting me arrested before too long. In all seriousness, I know that probably the majority of people would maybe think that it's hate speech. Certainly, at best, that it's out of date. At worst, that it's psychologically harmful. But what all I want to do with you this morning, and this is my pledge to you as we come to the Bible, all I want to do to you is share with you what your loving Creator, what God your Father, what his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, who gave his life for you, what he says is the best place and way for you to use your sexual desire. So shall we pray together? Let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, we thank and praise you. Your word is true and good and life. And we ask that as we come to it, so you would speak truth and goodness and life into our hearts, that we might know the Lord Jesus Christ, and that by the power of his Spirit, we might live lives of love for his glory. For his name's sake we pray. Amen. We live in a culture that's obsessed with sex. In fact, the idea of repressing or even controlling your sexual urges is totally alien to most people. Sex with who you want, when you want, is the norm. There's a greater openness about sex. Young people aren't just expected to be sexually aware, no, they're encouraged to be sexually active. It's the high point of pleasure. Sex is on every street corner. It's one of the gods that we worship. With our bodies, we worship the god of sex. And that's sex between men and women, married and unmarried, men and men, women and women, even sex with children. Because we live in first century Thessalonica. You see, the Christians that Paul is writing to in this city would have thought, well, around us people think we're just plain weird for this idea of a man being married to a woman and being sexually committed to one another for life. No, in Thessalonica, the job of your wife was to manage your household and to have your legitimate children. If you were a man, you'd go to your mistress for sex, or you go to your concubine, or to your slave, or maybe you go down to the temple, to the prostitutes that hung out there, where you worshipped your God through having an orgasm. But that was Thessalonica. And so for all our ideas of progress, actually as 21st century Britain has abandoned any idea that what the Bible says about sex might be a good thing, what we've done really is go back to first century Greece. Nah. That should not surprise us then, as Paul turns in this letter addressing a model church, a young church, from his heart for them to how they should believe to honor God. Well, he talks about sex. Now, the Bible's a very realistic book. It's why it has quite a lot to say about the things that dominate our lives, sex and money. And Paul knows he's got a tough job on convincing these quite new Christians to go against their culture, probably against what their family and friends are saying. He knows that standing out like this will have a cost for them. Ridicule? Almost certainly. Persecution for not approving of the way others behave? Probably. Being accused of being unloving, judgmental, out of touch? Very likely. So look how he starts by emphasizing exactly where this teaching comes from. Do you see that in the first verse of chapter 4? He says, "Finally, brothers and sisters, we instructed you how to live in order to please God, as in fact you are living. Now we ask you and urge you in the Lord Jesus to do this more and more." Our translation isn't brilliantly helpful here, that the word "finally," or in some translations, "as for other matters," has this sort of idea of Paul going, "Oh yeah, I've got a couple of things I'd like to say just before I close the letter." But that's miles away from Paul's tone. Because with sexual purity, the first question he's asking is this: do you want to please God, or do you want to please yourself? Do you want to please God, or do you want to please yourself? Because literally, verse 1 says, this is how you must walk to please God. Walking, because living for Jesus is an active, not a passive way of life. It's a moment by moment, step by step. Am I going to go this way or am I going to go that way? It's a look by look life as you walk down Gerrard's Cross High Street on a hot summer's day when most people appear to have abandoned their clothes. This is the way you're to walk, says Paul. And Thessalonian Christians, they've started to walk this way. But there's always progress to be made. It's like any loving relationship. You know, in a relationship, it's not about getting away with how much you can. No, it's about progressing in the way that you please the other person because you love them. And the same is true about our relationship with God. There's progress to be made. And Paul recognizes, though, that pleasing God, it's not really negotiable. But Paul's not giving advice. He's passing on what he received from the Lord. Again, the word "instructions" that we have in verse 2 of our translations, it's not helpful either. It's like something you get with your mobile phone that you ignore and then hope you can work it out as you go along by experimenting. But that's not to be our attitude to sex. No, God's instructions about sex, the word "instructions" here is the word for a military command. This is an order you're given by someone who has authority over you that you have to obey. And in case we still don't get it, Paul reminds us who our commanding officer is. In verse 1, he urges them in the Lord Jesus. In verse 2, he says, by the authority of the Lord Jesus. Now, I guess if you're a Christian here this morning, you want to please God. I guess it saddens you when you know you let him down or you disobey him. Sadly, I think a lot of people have been sold a false Christianity in our society. It's where God exists to please you. He's the sort of God who turns up in your life when it's going wrong and sorts it out. He's the God there who makes you feel better about yourself. He's the God who affirms you and lets you do what you want. But our God loves you too much to let you do what you want. So that's just not true. Because you and I are not the center of the universe. God is. You and I actually don't know what's best for us. God does. Because you and I did diddly squat when it came to creating all things or sustaining all life. God's done it all. So when it comes to the matter of sexual purity, there's no room for maneuver. There are no negotiations to be made about whether we should obey or not. There's no option about taking God's word seriously or not. If you want to please God, says Paul, then the way the Bible teaches is the way you have to walk out your life. So how does the one who created sex say we should use it? That's the second question. It's this: sexual purity. Do you want to be like God or the world? Do you want to be like God or the world? Because actually our attitude to sex is to reflect the love of the God we worship. I look at the beginning of verse 3 with me. Paul says, it's God's will that you should be sanctified. Sanctification is becoming more holy. To be holy is to be set apart to be like God for God. It's to take on the family likeness of our loving Heavenly Father, to have more and more the beautiful character of our brother, the Lord Jesus Christ. Holy is what God is. Holy is what we will be perfectly in heaven. You see, there's nothing more lovely, more compassionate, more tender, more kind, more gentle, more good than holy. And so Paul says, to be like God, avoid sexual immorality. Now, this isn't avoid like I avoid eating sugary foods because they're bad for you, but sometimes I'm a bit naughty and I have a chocolate cake. This is avoid like I avoid driving the wrong way down the motorway. Okay, avoid here would be better abstain. We're to be far more wary of sexual immorality than we are of getting COVID. You know, and in case you think that means that what I'm saying is as long as you wear PPE, you can have godly sex. Let me just remind you what the Bible says is the place of sex. God places sex at the heart of the marriage relationship between a man and a woman. It's not just a way of making children. It's the ultimate expression of their love, of their union. A union that God brings about when you get married. So Sam and Steph, when you, on your wedding day, it's not Merrick that's marrying you. It's not the Church of England that's marrying you. God will marry you and join you together. And you know when you're married. I hope you know when you're married. It's not going out. That's not marriage. It's not engaged. That's not marriage. It's not I'm soon to get married. That's not marriage. It's not living together. However long you have lived together, however committed you are in living together, that is not marriage. When you've said your vows to one another and you're exiting the church or the registry office, then you're married. If you've not done that, you're not married. And right from the start of the Bible, God defines what marriage is. Genesis 2:24, a man leaves his father and mother and is united to his wife, and they become one flesh. From the beginning, actually, to the end of the Bible, marriage is given primarily as a picture of God's relationship with his people. He is faithful, committed, loving, sacrificial, protective, permanent relationship. And when we keep sex within marriage, we're expressing the beauty of our intimacy with God in the beauty of our intimacy with one another. We are being holy. Because sex in marriage is an expression of that commitment and love, as God is committed to us, as God has loved us in his Son, the Lord Jesus, given for us. Now, I think I'm right in saying that humans are unique in being able to actually have sex face to face. That's because it is the most intimate relational moment. It's not just functional. No, God's created us uniquely, physically, man and woman, so we can come together united as one flesh and enjoy our union together. But enjoying that will mean a struggle. Did you see how realistic Paul is in verse 4? Each of you should learn to control your own body in a way that is holy and honorable. The word body is literally the word vessel, more not really in a ship sort of sense, but in your cereal bowl, something that carries something. It can be used in the New Testament for a wife or a husband. The word control also can be used for the word take. So there's some disagreement about what this verse means. Does it mean men should learn to only have sex with their wives? Or does it mean that we should all learn to control our own bodies physically in this area? Of course, it doesn't really make a huge amount of difference when it comes to applying it, does it? The God-like and God-honoring place for the most intimate, precious, loving act is in the safety of the lifelong committed relationship of marriage. And that requires learning control, says Paul. In other words, that ain't going to be easy. That's actually not going to feel natural some of the time. That's, by the way, why having a healthy sexual relationship within marriage is vital. There may be medical reasons why that becomes impossible. But in general, if you're not having regular sex with your husband, he's having it with someone else. Probably in his mind. Possibly with his body. And Paul's not stupid. Remember, control means abstaining. Keeping away from sexual arousal outside marriage. Not sort of seeing how far you can get away with things. Walking up to the line. So it's not everything's okay apart from penetrative sex. It's not everything's okay as long as we keep our clothes on. It's keeping away from anything that arouses you, so basically you want to have sex with the other person now. That includes what you watch, as well as what you do. And yet, let's not be naive. Pornography is rife in our society. The internet has made it so much easier than sneaking into the newsagents and trying to reach for the top shelf without being seen. Statistics say that probably 50% of the men who are listening to this sermon are using porn reasonably regularly. Your teenage son has looked at pornography. Your teenage grandson has looked at pornography. When I talked to my boys about this, I didn't ask them, have you looked at pornography? I asked them, how much are you looking at porn? And I asked them, are you struggling? Are you fighting to try and not do that? How can I help? I realized how different the culture our kids are growing up in when a young guy in the last church that we were involved in came to me and said he'd just been to a party where a girl in her mid-20s had come up to him and quite openly said, as though this was a normal thing, that her aim in life was to have sex with 50 men before she was 30. And she said quite proudly she was halfway there. And then just a couple of weeks later, I read in The Telegraph, couldn't you believe it, The Telegraph magazine, an article about Tinder. And it was a girl in her mid-20s, your normal Surrey middle-class girl, describing how she hooked up with men. And then the following morning, her mum would drive around the Surrey countryside after she'd rung her and pick her up. It was a bit like, you know, my mum used to pick me up from those birthday parties in the 1970s I went to where we had jelly and ice cream, but slightly different. It's just totally normal. And within the church, we need to realize the pressure that our young people are under. It's a different world out there. The world's attitude to sex actually hasn't really changed since first century Thessalonica. Do you see that in verse 5 of our reading? Paul says, they're not to be in passionate lust like the pagans who do not know God. Passionate lust sort of sounds a bit steamy, doesn't it? But it's simply doing what feels good to you. The word passionate is your desires. Lusts are what you do with those desires. And of course, Paul says, if you don't know God, well, you're not going to accept that he knows what's best for you, so you're going to do what feels good. And our culture worships personal gratification of doing what you want when you want. We've largely adopted the ideas of Sigmund Freud, or as I like to call him, Sigmund Fraud. The guy who says that suppressing your sexual desires is dangerous. It's bad for you. More than that, in our crazy postmodern culture, it's not just now that you must act on what you feel. We've become what we feel. That's who you are, says our world. So if you're a man who desires to have a sexual relationship with a man, or a woman who desires to have a sexual relationship with a woman, the world is saying to you, unless you fulfill your sexual desires, you deny who you are. Your identity is confined to your sexuality. The world says you'll find peace by fulfilling your passions. But God says to you, no, you'll find peace in my tender love, accepted as who you are, a child of God created in his image. You'll find peace being accepted by Christ, whatever you've done. Now again, there'll be many of us, many amongst us, struggling with same-sex attraction. I fancy you probably feel daily isolated rejected because you're gay and a Christian. You just don't know how that works. That's why we absolutely have to be a church where no one feels excluded because of their sexual orientation or their gender dysphoria. We must be a family where gay people can come and they won't just hear of the grace and love of God in the Lord Jesus Christ from the front. They will experience that love in the way that we throw our arms around them and welcome them into our family. Because it's going to be hard. The Bible's view of sex cuts right across our culture. But it says to us, there's a better way. That's what God says to you this morning. There is a better way. You know, the Bible's view, of course, is theological. It says God's word is right and good, whereas our feelings are fallen and riddled with sin. The Bible's view is biological. It says that only sex can only be between a man and a woman, because in the end, God has created us like that, with the sexual organs that can come together in unity. The Bible's view is philosophical. Because it says the way that you are physically is not less important than the way you perceive yourself mentally. You can't separate those things. Your body is not just a vehicle for your desires or something to be changed because of the way you feel. Your body is good and beautiful and God-given, however you feel about it. It's psychological. Because it says it's actually not the best thing for your mental health to run with your desires, whatever they may be. Freud was wrong. That the peace and security are found in the love of God in Christ, not in unrepressed sexual expression. And it's sociological. Because it's claiming that marriage between a man and a woman is the place where sexual intimacy is to be enjoyed and where children are to be raised. And that is the best plan for our society. And so we as God's people must live out that plan and we must love our neighbors enough to say to them, do you know, this would be best for you as well. But the Bible's view is not political. It's not political. So as Christians, we're not to try and legislate about how people who don't know God should behave. You see, the most important thing for every man, woman, and child, whoever they are and whatever they believe, is that they come to know the love of God in the Lord Jesus. Therefore, I don't believe we should campaign for people who don't know Jesus to live God's way. You know when you'll find the Bible's teaching really hard, don't you? It's not when RuPaul's drag show flashes up as the first thing offered you on iPlayer again. But it's when your grandson comes out as gay and he introduces you to his very kind, very gentle, loving partner. Or it's when your self-harming daughter says that she's found a friend at university and you can't help but notice she just seems so much happier. And then you find that she and Charlotte share a bed together. God wants so much better for us. He longs for so much better. Not just because our behavior can dishonor him, no, because it damages us. Did you see that in verse 6? Look at the beginning of verse 6. Paul says, in this matter, no one should wrong or take advantage of a brother or sister. When we indulge our sexual desires outside marriage, we wrong people. We encourage other people to sin. We take advantage of them. Even if they're fully consenting, what we do is we use their weakness for our pleasure. Oh, God was way ahead of the Me Too movement. He has far higher standards. He wants the unique intimacy of sex protected. So the only place for safe sex is consensual sex within marriage. The only place for safe sex is consensual sex within marriage. And when we treat sex like that, we're being holy. We're being godlike. Because our God is the God that though we have wronged him, he never wrongs us. And our God is the God that though we take advantage of him, he sent his son to die for us. And our God is the God who humbly gives up the pleasure of heaven and in complete self-control walks the road to a cross where he bears all our sin and shame to cleanse us from all sin, sexual or otherwise, where he takes the punishment that we deserve for the way we reject him and the way we use each other. Because make no mistake, because God loves us, sexual immorality angers him. Because lastly, here's the last thing, it's just briefly. Do you take this seriously or do you reject God? But Paul emphasized, didn't he, at the beginning of our reading, this teaching was the command of God. And he actually ups the stakes in the last couple of verses. Look at the end of verse 6. He says, "The Lord will punish all those who commit such sins, as we told you and warned you before." When Jesus returns, sexual sin will be on the list of things that he will punish people for. Jesus hates all kind of exploitation. Jesus hates the way that people use each other physically. It grieves him. And when the secrets of people's hearts are revealed, if you've paid lip service to following Christ while actually serving our own desires in the bedroom, then we will face his righteous anger rather than receiving his gracious welcome. Now don't hear me wrong. We have all fallen in this area of sexual immorality. Oh, you just don't know how far we've fallen. You don't know how far I've fallen. We have all fallen in this area and continue to win and lose some battles day by day and week by week. It's a struggle, either in mind or body, either by having sex outside marriage or maybe not having sex within marriage. We have all fallen. But the warning here is for anyone who's not struggling, but indulging. Anyone who's not getting help with sexual sin, but hiding it. Whether it's adultery. Let's not call it an affair. That sounds gentle. This is just plain, selfish adultery. Whether it's pornography. Let's not pretend there's good pornography and bad pornography. It's all exploitive. Whether it's sex outside marriage. Let's not pretend it's our way of showing love to someone else when it's our way of getting our own gratification. Please seek help. That's what the Lord says. You're not alone in your battles. There is forgiveness. There is always forgiveness in the cleansing blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he longs for you to turn to him today, to come to him, to talk to a friend, maybe he's a Christian who you trust. I mean, I'd love to meet with you, to pray with you, to talk about our common struggles, and to seek the grace of our God together. Because God sent his son to die not so that we could go on living the impure life of the world, but so we could be holy like him, serving, giving in love to others. And if you reject the Bible's teaching on sex, if you reject what the Apostle Paul says here, dare I even say this, if you reject what I've said in this sermon, look what you're doing according to verse 8. Therefore, anyone who rejects this instruction does not reject a human being, but God, the very God who gives you his Holy Spirit. Please hear the word of the Lord to you today. Don't harden your heart against your loving Heavenly Father. Listen to the convicting voice of the Spirit of Jesus in your heart and come back to him, the one whose arms are flung open with you. Come back to the one who, by the power of his Spirit, is telling you that he longs for you to find security and peace and forgiveness and love in him. Come back to him today. Let's pray. I'm just going to leave some moments of quiet for you to do business with God as you see fit. And then Merrick is going to come and lead us in a confession.